Hello.
Welcome.
How are you all?
I, oddly enough, don't have that sort of with people in Downpatrick. What's that? Welcome to Downpatrick.
Great to be here.
Yeah. You ever been here before?
I was here once for a rally, but I never did a gig. This is my first ever gig in Downpatrick. So and hopefully not the last.
You're in County Down, of course, yes. Which is the home county of your family way back.
Mum's side, yeah.
Where from?
My nan is one of 10, and they're all from Warren Point.
Oh.
So up the point.
So what's the connection then between Warren Point and Liverpool, where you were born? How far back does that go?
It goes back three generations, really, now. And I obviously grew up surrounded by Irish music, and I was sent for Irish dancing lessons when I was 4, and I think I lasted 10 minutes, and they sent me straight back home. So I stuck to the music. I learned Tin Whistle as a kid through Cultus, and used to enter the Flowers, and then started playing the accordion. And I think I've gradually got worse as the years have gone on, playing accordion, but loved, you know, obviously, Nan is one of 10, as I said, and
Nan is your grandmother.
My mum's mum.
Your mum's mum.
So, so two of her brothers played fiddle and sang and danced, and Nan has done ceilidh dancing all her life and set dancing. So that's where the kind of music, where I grew up. And
well, who went to Liverpool first? How did they end up in Liverpool?
So the story was that my Nan's mum and dad had their first few children, and times got really tough. And
here,
yeah, in County Down, and couldn't really see a way out, so decided that they'd go to America. So they got on a boat to Liverpool, and they were going to get the main ship to New York. And on the boat over to Liverpool, they got robbed, and all their money and possessions were taken.
Oh.
So they ended up staying in Liverpool and had to set up there, and that's why I speak with an accent like this, I suppose. Somewhere in the middle. Yeah.
So then they were in Liverpool, and then they had three children, is that right?
So Nan then had three girls, my mum, Una and Siobhan. And they had three. And my mum and dad, when they were 21. And I'm one of three as well. I'm the eldest.
You've got Kira and
Jake. Yeah, he's the baby.
Now, I'll be asking questions about the family tree very shortly, so make sure you remember all that. And then on the 28th of May, was it?
1990.
A certain Nathan Kane Tyrone Anthony Carter.
They couldn't decide.
Nathan Kane Tyrone Anthony Carter.
There's actually John in there as well.
Seriously?
Yeah, my confirmation name is John.
Really?
So
it's Nathan Kane Tyrone Anthony John Carter.
Yeah.
You must have been very special to have all those names.
So signing checks takes me a long time, as you can imagine. You know?
Do you know the significance of the names? Do you?
I was the first grandchild with my nan and grumps, as I call them. And
you were supposed to be a girl, of course, weren't
yeah,
you?
Yeah, they all wanted a girl. So my granddad never had a boy. They had three girls. So he said if he ever had a boy, he was going to call him Kane after... he was going to call him Tyrone, after Tyrone Power, who was an actor.
Yes.
Way before my time. And everyone looked too young in here to remember Tyrone Power. And my mum wanted Kane, and my dad wanted Nathan. And they took me to get christened, and the priest turned around and said, there's no saint's names in there. So his name was Father Anthony. So that's how I got Anthony. If there wasn't enough
true?
Names.
Is that true?
That's the truth. Yeah.
So there you are, living in Liverpool with all these fancy names. Yeah. What was life like growing up in Liverpool in the 90s? And how strong was that Irish tradition in the family?
It was great, yeah. I mean, I didn't like school. I wasn't really that academic, to be honest. I used to skip lessons and go and hang out in the music room. And But I was in a choir growing up, in our school choir, and that was great teaching, really, from I was like 11 till I was, I left school at 16 then. But we went and sang for the Pope in Rome, and we toured America, and went to Holland and all these random places, singing in cathedrals.
What was the choir?
It was St. Francis Xavier's Boys Choir, so the school was called St. Francis Xavier's.
Yeah, you ended up head chorister there,
didn't
you?
I was head chorister for a while, so that was good because I had to kind of look after the group and plan trips and,
you know. Actually were on Top of the Pops.
We were on Top of the Pops as well. Yeah.
With who?
There was a Liverpool band called The Farm, and they had a song called All Together Now, which got re-released for...
Some football.
I'm not into football. I haven't a clue what it was for, but the song ended up going top 10.
Wow.
And we got invited as the choir to be on Top of the
Pops. What age were you then?
I was 14.
Do you want to see yourself?
No. I really don't. Oh, jeez. Where did you get this?
Do you have a black eye there?
I paid someone a lot of money to make sure that was never getting seen ever again.
Oh, we found
Where
it.
Where did you get it from?
We found it. Oh, is that a black eye?
I don't think so.
Is it just a shadow?
What's the shadow again?
What do you see? Look, that's a black eye. Somebody hit you. Look.
I was talking when I should have been listening, obviously, yeah.
What kind of a feeling was that? There you were top of the pot.
Oh, that was mad, yeah. I remember sitting next to Pharrell Williams, who's like a black rapper, and we were exactly sitting like as far away from him as this, and we just didn't know what to say or what to do, and who else was on that night? Westlife were on as well. mad, you know? So I was only 14, and... But a great experience to go into the music business after that, and it was good.
Were you always destined for the music business? I mean, at the age of 4, you asked Santa Claus for a special present.
He did,
and he brought it.
A squeeze box, yeah, to my
an accordion.
To my mum and dad's, God love them. Oh, I was every single hour of the day I'd be there. Couldn't play a note.
Why did you pick that? It's an odd instrument for a child.
Well, my dad's dad, John, so he played the accordion all his life. Not professionally, he was a builder and all, but I used to see him playing tunes every now and again, so I grew up with it, and I took it up. Now, there's easier instruments than
there are
to carry around. Like,
yeah.
My mum often said, could you not have learnt the tin whistle, you know, rather than... Because I'd be going to school, pulling this thing on a trolley, like, you know, up and down, and so...
And then, as you were saying earlier, you came to many of the flas here in Ireland.
Yeah.
Whose influence was that? Was that Nan's or was that your mum's? Why were you doing that?
Yeah, it was Nan's, really. But I always loved trad music. I loved folk music. And in our house at home, my granddad would play like the Dubliners and the Chieftains and Sharon Shannon and Christie and Mary Black and all those singers. Yeah. So I just grew up, like, I was seriously odd at school. Like, all my friends were there listening to Eminem,
yes.
And I was listening to Kenny Rogers or Philomena Begley. Like, it was just so random.
But you won the All-Ireland traditional singing.
I did, yeah, yeah.
I don't
know if there's many Liverpool people will win an All-Ireland singing competition, but I did. It was like, I think it was 15. It was in Letterkenny in Donegal, and I won that, yeah.
What did you sing?
I sang... a song called Erin Graham McCree, which is an old, very old
And you're a fluent Irish speaker, of course.
Of course, yeah. Agus. Hoag Mahone, that's the only other one. I know all the bad ones.
So you won the All-Ireland. You couldn't give us a little verse of that, could you?
I actually can't remember it. I'm not just saying that. I don't think I remember it now.
Well, look, maybe you'll sing something for us, senior.
I will. I'll sing something.
Is JP there? Give JP a round of applause. John Patrick, you've been with Daniel and Sally for 10 years now, man and boy. What are you going to think? Caledonia?
Yeah,
we'll be. Somebody asked for this.
I recognise a good few of these faces as well.
It's great to be out, isn't it? Great to be out.
Well, will you say hello to one of your fans, super fans in the audience, Ellie May Bell?
Hello, Ellie May.
There she's there.
How are you?
Nine. It says here, who loves to follow you and never misses a concert in the north. She's even brought you a rose. She brought you a rose to your banger. No, to the banger concert. She hasn't got it. She has assigned Nathan Bear with her tonight.
Wow.
And she wouldn't sleep until she knew that she had a ticket for tonight.
Ah. It's lovely to see you.
Give her a round of applause.
Okay, so we'll do Caledonia. And if you know it, sing along.
Well, I don't know if you can see the changes that have come over me in these last few days. Well, I've been afraid that I might drift away, but I've been telling old stories and singing songs that make me think about where that I came from, and that's the reason why I seem so far away today. So let me tell you that I love you. I think about you all the time. Caledonia called me. Now I'm going home. And if I should become a stranger, you know it'll make me more than sad. Caledonia's been everything I've ever had. Well, I have moved, I've kept on moving, proved the points that I need to prove them. Lost those friends that I needed losing, found others on the way. I've kissed those girls and I've left them crying. Stolen dreams, yes, there's no denying. Traveled hard with my conscience flying. Summer in the wind. Let's hear you sing it. So let me tell you that I love you. I think about you all the time. Caledonia, you call me. Now I'm going home. If I should become a stranger, it'll make me more than sad. This Caledonia's been everything I've ever had. Well, I'm sitting here before the fire, the empty room and the forest choir. The flames that can't get any higher, they've withered now, they've gone. But I'm steady thinking that my way is clear, and I know what I will do tomorrow. When the hands are shaken and the kisses flow, and I will disappear. So let me tell you that I love you, and I think about you all the time. Caledonia, you're calling me. Now I'm going home. If I should become a stranger, it'll make me more than sad. 'Cause Caledonia's been everything I've ever had. Oh yes, Caledonia's been everything I've ever had.
JP. Thank you, JP. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You left school at what, 16?
Yeah.
You must have hated it, did you?
Hated it. Hated every minute of it. You see, I'd started doing gigs in a lot of the pubs and bars around Liverpool, and I figured out that you could make a bit of money from singing.
Yeah.
So all my friends were there doing Saturday jobs and Sunday jobs and coming in with 10 quid an hour, less actually, probably 5 quid an hour. And then I'd go and do a gig and I'd make in one night what they'd made in a month. So I seen this and I was like, what am I doing in school? I need to be gigging.
But what did your parents say when you said, I want to leave school at 16?
They weren't happy.
I bet
my mum wanted me to go to college or to uni and become, get a degree. But I actually wasn't clever enough, to be honest with you. I wouldn't have had the brains really
staying
to do
power
it. My nan convinced my mum to let me go and do the gigs, and basically what was said was, my mum said, well, if he's going out doing these gigs at night, then nan, you need to go with him. Which was great crack. That's what from I was 16 onwards, my nan's been traveling around and coming to the gigs. Now, I couldn't drive back then, so nan would drive me to the gigs and she'd sell the merchandise. And 16, I'm now 32 this year, so what's that?
That's 16 years ago.
17 years this year. She's still selling my merchandise.
She still does it?
Yeah.
What age is your nan now?
She's 82.
And she travels everywhere with you?
Yeah, she's flying to Belfast tomorrow morning to get a car down with one of the lads to... where are we tomorrow, JP? Ballybunion. Do you know
Ballybunion? Yeah. Great golf course there. So
there
great
is,
golf.
Apparently.
Oh, great golf course.
So, yeah, she's travelling down to do 2 nights in Ballybunion, Tullamore on Sunday, and then she'll fly back home then. So, yeah.
You must have a fabulous relationship with her.
Yeah, she's great fun. She really is. And she never grew up, really, you know. She's like, we'd be on a tour bus in England or Scotland and she'd be the last one up, you know. G&T, you know.
Does she?
Yeah.
What was the story? Didn't she drive people around at one stage at some job and she got a Merc to drive somebody around?
She used to work for Liverpool Football Club.
That's what it was.
There was a manager called Gerard Houllier.
Yes.
And she.
You really know nothing about football, do you?
I actually don't. I haven't a clue. She used to be given like a Mercedes or a BM or whatever to take these footballers or managers about. And as my granddad would say, unfortunately, she's got a heavy right foot. And God love them, they used to get in very tan looking, then be white when they got out of the car. But she turned up one day and there was no vehicle for her, so she had to drive her own car, which was a I think it was 22-year-old Honda Civic with bottles and papers everywhere and wrappers, chocolates and just everything. So Gerard Houllier was sitting in the front of this Honda Civic with wrappers. But she's been so good to me through the years.
Well, you've repaid her in many ways, by just being you, but secondly... materially, you paid her back too because you bought her a very special present a few years back.
But she drove these Mercedes from the football club for years and she always said that she wanted one. So it was her 75th birthday and we'd had a good year. And I turned around and I bought her a Mercedes.
Wouldn't we all love a grandson like that, wouldn't we? Did you ever have a proper job at all?
No. Well, I worked with my dad for a year as a...
In the building trade?
Well,
what did you do there?
I was awful. I was just the worst.
What did you do?
I was just a labourer, to be honest, and I tried to do a bit of plastering and a bit of bricklaying, but the wall didn't stay up long, put it that way, you know.
How long did that last?
Lasted a year. And then the gigs, it was in between kind of when I was 16, 17, and there'd be gigs at weekend, but my dad was like, you're not staying in the house all week, you must be joking. I'd be like, I'm learning songs, and I wasn't like, I was just watching TV. But so I went out and I did a year with him, and it really taught me how much to appreciate music, yes, you know, and to be able to do something you love, there's nothing can compare to it, you know, because I really didn't like that.
Well, it's a good lesson. At 19 years of age, you decided, that's it, I'm going full time on that.
Yeah.
And you up sticks from Liverpool, and you came to live in Fermanagh. You came to Northern.
I came to live in Donegal originally.
Donegal originally, yes. That's right.
I was there for 3 years.
Why did that decision come about?
Nan's best friend lived in Donegal, and I had done a gig when I was 18 in Buncrana, a charity gig. I came over to do it. I'd released an album and it was getting played on Highland Radio quite a bit. So yeah, there was a charity fundraiser and they rang me up, said, would you like to come and sing a few songs? And I said, yeah, I'd love to. So came over, done the gig, and met John Farry, who is my manager now. And John met me on the night, and he said, oh, I love what you're doing. And he said, myself and another guy, James, are thinking of putting a band on the road. And would you like to front the band? And, you know, we'll make you the next big thing. And I was kind of, I don't know. Because the gigs were starting to go good. In England, there was doing a one-man show.
And money was being made there.
Yeah. It was doing okay, you know. So.
And you came here with no real reputation.
No one knew me at all. So I said, I'll try it for a couple of years and see how we get on. So my nan's best friend lived in Donegal. So she says, I'll look after him. I'll put him up and do the washing and do the ironing. And I'll cook for him. And I think I went there and I was about like 11 stone. And after 3 years of living there, I was about 13 stone. She did the best homemade, what's it called? The scone bread with the raisins in.
Soda bread.
With the raisins in, though. Is that
you can have raisins in it. If you were in Donegal, you could, but you wouldn't have them here.
No. Not a County Down thing, no.
Not a County Down thing.
No.
Again, what did the parents say about you? Because you were their number one child. You were the eldest.
Yeah, I was emotional leaving, though.
I bet.
I was the eldest leaving home. So, but they kind of knew I was doing something I loved, so they were happy enough. And the first couple of years were not great. Like, to be honest, we didn't go on some nights. You'd turn up to a gig and there might be 20 people there, you know. And
really?
You'd be saying, oh, we'll wait till there's, you know, at least 40 in. But the 40 never came, so you'd pack up the gear and then go travelling somewhere else, and then you'd be so afraid that another band would see you that you didn't do the gig because there wasn't enough people in, you know. But thankfully it started to get better, especially in the north. There was, back then, this is like, what, 9 years ago now, like a lot of younger people started getting into dancing and going out, and there was kind of the whole country music thing just took a revival.
Oh, well, when did country music become fascinating to you? Like, cause
it was always on in the house.
Was
so
it?
My granddad is a huge fan of Charlie Pride, Johnny Cash. I always say he loves Dolly Parton, and there's two big reasons why he loves Dolly Parton. She's fantastic legs, obviously. So, but it was always on, and then the Irish Centre in Liverpool was just closing when I was like 5 or 6, but I used to go in on a Sunday and there'd be like Brendan Shine playing, or Philomena Begley, or Foster and Allen, or, you know, them sort of bands. I used to sit there and be fascinated by all these bands, and I used to go and help with the gear, bringing the gear in for them and taking it out at the end, and just loved it. So so that's where the country music, and I kind of went off it when I was like early teens, and then I got back into it again.
See, most people look at you today, you know, massive star at the moment, as if life was always easy. It wasn't easy at the start. Like, you have served your apprenticeship.
Yeah, I'd like to think so. And I don't think anyone gets it easy, really. Do you know what I mean? Unless you're on X Factor and you go from, you know, zero to
hero.
Yeah, overnight. But that doesn't happen for a lot of people. You know, it's kind of years and years of gigs and radio stations and interviews. And as you know, you've interviewed the best of the best. So. But you know, you wouldn't change it if you love music that much. You'd do anything for it. So,
you see, not since Daniel O'Donnell first hit the scene, and maybe Charlie or Garth Brooks when he came here, I've never seen and an audience that takes so much to people as they do to you. Like, you are a phenomenon today.
Tell me about that.
But I know that's down to talent, but it's down to hard work. This is a job for you.
Yeah.
This is not just for fame and fortune. You actually treat this business very seriously.
Yeah, well, I never really got into it to become famous. I think that's probably the difference between anyone who goes gigging in pubs and clubs and doing all that stuff, or you go on a talent show because you want to be famous.
Yeah.
I was offered the chance to go on Pop Idols back in the day.
Really?
I just turned it down because I was like, no, I don't really want to do that. And I don't sing pop stuff, so it wasn't for me. But I think you want to get into the business because you want to be in music and you want to have a career for a long time. I have the utmost respect for the people who have lasted in the industry. You know, for me, that's success.
Yeah.
It's not about money or accolades or winning awards or anything like that. You know, it's about being able to have a career for many, many years. I look at the likes of Philomena Begley, who's like 60 years on the road.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's this year or last year, but like, for me, that's the epitome of success, you know.
Our Philomena's in the hall, isn't she? did any of them approach you at the start when you came here? Did Philomena or Daniel give you a hand up, a leg up?
Yeah. I actually said on the Late Late Show one time, I made an absolute boo boo, and I said Philomena Begley was the first woman in Ireland to get me up. I meant up on stage, not, you know, it came out totally wrong. But she was. I did a gig in Donegal, and it was actually that charity gig I was saying, and the night after I stayed and went to the Abbey in Donegal Town, and Philomena was on, and she brought me up on stage. She'd heard that I sang, and she said, we'll give this young lad a shot, you know, so, and we've become friends ever since.
Yeah.
Like she would give you a call every
and Daniel the same. He is.
Daniel's been terrific. Yeah, he's been really, really good. Like, I went out to America for the first time about 4 years ago, pre-COVID, and we were gigging in Branson, and he does like 4 or 5
weeks
at a time.
Yeah.
And we were gigging in the little theatre up the road, and he rang me up. He said, listen, if you want to come up and sing a song during my show and promote yours, the night, he does the daytime and we were doing the night. So like, there's really not many people that would do that.
No.
you know, and
he means it too.
He does. And he's been very, very good. Not just to me as well. Like any of the younger country singers, like Lisa and Cleona and Derek and all them singers. So.
Was there one event or one night that turned things around for you, that from obscurity to be known?
I think the Late Late Show was probably a big one.
Your first appearance on it.
The first time on that, yeah. But the funny thing was, I'd released Wagon Wheel and they wouldn't let me sing it. They wanted me to sing a Green Day song, which is a rock band. They wanted me, I'd done a cover version of Time of Your Life, and they insisted on me singing that. So they wouldn't let me sing. So then, but you can't talk to RTE sometimes, like they have their own.
Yeah.
So I went along with it, and then they had me back on then 6 months later singing Wagon Wheel then. But it was great actually, because it meant that it got a second shot,
yes,
then,
yes.
You know, and it that song just seemed to, we just couldn't stop it. It just took off. And
well, it's not RTE here, and we'll let you sing it for us. JP, you know the chords of this one, JP? just about.
Yeah.
This is now, is it 10 years old?
It's 10 years old this month, yeah.
I can't believe it.
Yeah.
2012 it was released.
I know. How time flies.
How time flies. And if you know the words, don't join in.
Down, 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 down. I headed down south to the land of the pines. I thumb on my way to North Carolina. Staring up the road, pray to God I see headlights. I made it down the coast in 17 hours, picking me a bouquet of dogwood flowers. I'm hoping for rallies so I can see my baby tonight.
You ready?
So rock me, mama, like a wagon wheel. Rock me, mama, in a way you feel. We're singing, hey, hey, yeah, mama, rock me. Yeah, rock me, mama, like the wind and the rain. Rock me, mama, like a southbound train. Hey, yeah, yeah, mama, rock me. Was running from the cold up in New England. Born to be a fiddler in an old-time string band. My baby plays the guitar, I pick the banjo now. Oh, the North Country winters keep getting me down. Lost my money playing poker, so I have to believe I ain't turning back to live with that old life no more, yeah. So rock me, mama, like a wagon wheel. Rock me, mama, in a way you feel. Hey, hey, mama, rock me. Yeah, rock me, mama, like the wind and the rain. Rock me, mama, like a southbound train. Hey, hey, yeah, mama, rock me. Was walking to the south out of Roanoke. Caught a trucker out of Philly at a nice long toke. He's heading west from the Cumberland Gap to Johnson City, Tennessee. I gotta get a move on before the sun. If a baby call my name, she's the only one. As if I die in a rally, at least I will be free, yeah. So rock me, mama, like a wagon wheel. Rock me, mama, in a way you feel. Hey, yeah, yeah, mama, rock me. Right, you're on your own. You ready? Let's do it. So rock me. We're singing, hey, hey. Just the ladies. Go on, ladies, on your own. Sing it. Rock me. You're watching this. All the boys, go on, lads. Jesus.
Oh, lad.
Last time. So rock me, mama, like a wagon wheel. Rock me, mama, in a way you feel. Hey, hey, yeah, mama, rock me. So rock me, mama, like the wind and the rain. Rock me, mama, like a southbound train. Hey, yeah, yeah, mama, rock me. Down, 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 down.
Well done.
Interesting how the female voices outshone the male voices there. where did you get that song? Bob Dylan started writing that, didn't he?
He originally wrote part of it, and then it was finished by a band called the Old Crow Medicine Show,
yes,
a bluegrass band, and that's who I heard singing it.
Did you pick it up yourself? Did you think?
Yeah,
that,
yeah.
Did
yeah.
you know from the start that that would be a hit?
I knew it was annoyingly catchy, if that makes any sense. That makes any sense. And I hadn't recorded anything in that tempo before, so it was new for me. But as I said, we did a video then on Rosnaula Beach.
On the beach with the Donegal Volkswagen,
yeah, and that kind of just
van.
Took off then, you know. So,
what age were you appealing for then? Were you appealing for the over 40s, the under 40s, the under 20s?
You see, it's where are we going with this question?
I'm not sure. It all depends on your answer.
I'll be totally honest. I mean, our age group back then was an older age group, but then releasing that, it kind of introduced me to a younger age group rather than the mature age group.
Yes, yes.
But it ended up getting played in nightclubs and at weddings and all that. And like, I was in Coppers last week and they played it twice while I was in the bloody place that I'm going to. Not
knowing,
again.
Knowing that you were there?
Not
or?
Again. When I was in the place.
Oh,
yeah. And they didn't know I was in.
Oh, right.
Yeah. I was at the bar going, oh, not again.
It's but true to say, though, it changed your life.
It did, yeah. It introduced me to a whole lot of people that had never heard of my name before, you know. So we'll be forever grateful for that song.
How well did it do? You know how many you sold?
I don't know, because then whenever we released that, it was just in the time where we were going on to downloads and iTunes, and now we're on streaming platforms. Yeah. So it's very
it's hard to
judge, you know. But the album itself, we released an album, then Wagon Wheel, that did great. It went to number one and went back to number one a few weeks later and stuff. So it was
your audience today is anything from like 9 years old to... Forty-nine. It's difficult to appeal to that broad spectrum of audience, is it not?
It is, but you know, it kind of it always makes for a great gig because it's just a very family orientated atmosphere there. It's young and it's old and it's you still would get the odd pair of knickers thrown on the screen. And I think
the word is bloomers, actually.
Bloomers. And do you know who are the worst culprits for them? The older ones.
The older ones. If anybody feels like throwing their knickers up here tonight, do you? You mentioned the family feel that you have in your audience.
Yeah.
Family is it's hugely important to you anyway, the family back in Liverpool. Do you have any relatives here, back here in
No, Ireland? Well, my brother Jake, he lives in Dublin now.
Yeah. Well, does he? He's gone. He left the house?
He was living with me for a while, and then he settled down and got a dog.
I've done a lot of interviews in my life, but I've never quite been heckled by an audience before, so I tried to ask a question. How often will the family get over to see you now here? How does mum and dad come over?
They don't get over as much as they used to. My dad retired like a couple of years ago, and then he went back because he put on 3 stone. And my mum basically said, get back out to work because you're doing nothing. So yeah, they're busy again. But I see Jake every couple of weeks, and then of course I see Nan nearly every other week. So, but I go to Liverpool every now and again. I go once every month or every 6 weeks and go and see them.
You never read about you out in nightclubs and that type of thing. That doesn't particularly interest you.
Well, it does. I just don't tell anyone.
Oh, is that? That's a fair enough answer. That's a fair enough answer.
Yeah.
Before the pandemic, yeah. How many nights in the year were you working? Had you any idea?
It was pretty hectic. No, we would have been doing 120 gigs a year, and then I'd do interviews and press and TV as well on top of that, you know. So I would have been out.
So once every 3 nights you're around the country and around the world gigging.
Yeah, generally.
Like, look what you've done. You sang for the Pope in Croke Park.
Yeah.
You've headlined the Palladium. Yeah. You sold out the SSC Arena. You sold out the O2. You had your own television series, your own radio series. Jesus, I hate you. What other goals do you have?
I don't know. I've been asking myself that really the last year or so, because I always need something to focus on. Otherwise, I just end up going through the motions, you know. I kind of need something to aim towards. Yeah. But we are going to America at the end of the year, so, I mean, that's somewhere I'd love to be able to play, you know.
Croke Park.
Croke Park, yeah. There's a fella coming to town soon.
There is a guy coming. I'm going to ask you about that, because when this guy that came was supposed to come in, what, 2014, was it?
Mr. Garth Brooks.
Mr. Garth Brooks, you were supposed to be the support act that night.
Yeah, I'd been offered three nights, yeah.
This was 8 years ago he's talking about.
So
now he's coming back.
He is, yeah, yeah. And all I know is my name is in the hat.
How much?
No one has been told yet.
Right. How much? How much would it mean to you to get that gig?
It would be huge, yeah. I mean, I can remember when I was 6-7 years old, and my mum's sister, Siobhan, she married a fella who was from America. Well, he still is, obviously. and he brought back the VHS tapes. Remember the VHS? Of Garth Brooks Live. And it was at Crow Park, but they were selling them in the States.
Yes.
And I used to watch Garth coming in on these strings, flying over the crowd. And imagine as a 6-7 year old into music, like, this was just the best thing I'd ever seen in my life. So, you know, if I got to support him at some stage, it would be amazing.
Your songwriting as well, you're writing songs?
Doing a little bit, yeah. I'm actually going over to London in a couple of weeks' time to start writing with some new people that I've never written with. So that's kind of one thing that keeps the thing new and fresh. And
see, what the pandemic, the 2 years that you're off the road, you found those years quite tough, didn't you?
Oh, I did, yeah, yeah. I mean, it went from being literally on the road every week with something happening and the phone never stopped ringing to overnight nothing happening, and no one was ringing, and there was no gigs, there was no interviews, there was no nothing, you know, no band, which we're all best mates in the band, you know, we all go out together and gig together and we go for meals together. So I didn't see them for months and months and months, so it was pretty tough. But I mean, I was very fortunate to be able to be living where I was, and I was in the sticks and there was no one near me. But you know,
I did read somewhere though that there was times you found it difficult to get out of bed, you said.
Yeah, no, definitely. At one stage, like, I just had nothing to get up for, so I'd lie in bed for till 3 or 4 in the afternoon, eat absolute rubbish, and just there was nothing to do. So I was just, I guess I was kind of a bit depressed, you know. I didn't realize at the time, but it was just nothing to get up for, so just lie here and do nothing.
And was Jake with you at the time?
He was. Now, him and Karen, his partner, they ended up staying with me throughout 3 or 4 months of it. And she's mad into fitness. So she'd come up to the room in the morning and I get a bang on the door. Right, get up. No, I'm lying here. Go away. But she'd get me. She said, come on, we're going to do a class. So we'd end up doing a 20-minute hit class. So what's your mum with the frizzy hair?
Joe Wicks.
So we were on Joe Wicks every day. And I was probably in the best shape I've ever been, because she had me out, and then we'd go walks in the afternoon, and then you'd be, they're mad into eating healthy as well. So, whereas I just love a Chinese, to be honest. So, you know, that was good. It kind of kicked me into shape, you know.
So, been back and seeing audiences must have been a thrill for you.
Just a dream come true. Yeah.
How long are you back now? How long is did you start on the road again?
We've been gigging throughout, you know, properly about 6 months now. You know, we went and did English tour at the start of the year, and as you said, the Palladium and stuff like that, and then we've got a load of shows coming up. We're in Dublin for 3 nights, and festivals.
You're doing Vicar Street?
Yeah, we're doing Vicar Street for 3 nights.
You're back in County Down on the 5th of August.
Yeah, we're doing a festival out there.
You're doing
the
Fontenoy Festival at Leitrim, yeah?
Yeah. It's great to see these festivals happening again.
Yes.
Really, the 5th of August.
I just said that. I was counting between now and Christmas what you've already booked in officially. Mm. You've got 62 bookings already officially, and I'm sure there's more to come. So you have a hell of a autumn and winter coming up.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We've actually got to release more dates as well. So
I bet.
It is busy, but we're actually only catching up on stuff that should have happened last year and the year before, you know. So this year's mad, and there's actually way too many gigs on for everyone to go to. I mean, I've been to I think, 6 gigs, like going physically watching other people. That was my promise to myself this year. I said, I'm going to go out and
who would you watch? Who would you like?
Well, I seen Tom Jones a couple of weeks ago in Belfast. He was in the Botanic.
Yeah.
And I seen Rod Stewart, and I seen Carrie Underwood, seen Bryan Adams.
Oh, right.
And I seen Queen with Adam Lambert in the same within 3 nights of each other. I seen all these. So I'm getting to see a load of music because I stopped listening to music in lockdown. I just was fed up with it and didn't want to. And now I'm back into music again. That was my promise. I'm going to go and watch a load of acts.
And America would be important to crack America. It would be huge if you could get a little chunk of
it. It'd be nice to do stuff out there, you know. I mean, we're lucky enough. We go to England and Scotland, and then, of course, Ireland we do throughout the year, you know, anyway. We generally do a Christmas tour, and then we'll do festivals and stuff like that. So it'd be nice to have somewhere else just to be able to split the work.
And product-wise, what have you got at the moment?
Nothing at the minute. I released an album earlier this year, and I'm going to start working on a new album now in the next couple of months. I started a new band as well in lockdown called Kyole, which is 4 young guys, all really talented folk singers and musicians.
Oh, really?
And they're now on the road and they're pretty busy, and they're about to release their new EP for their first ever EP.
Are you looking after them?
Yeah, well, I'm kind of throwing my tuppence in every now and again, but there's a guy, Liam McKenna, who manages them. So
excellent.
But it's great to help new talent as well coming up. There's so many young talented musicians out there, and I was so fortunate to get, you know, a helping hand when I was starting out, so it's nice to do it again. You know, so.
Tell me, what's it like standing in the SSA Arena or the O2 or the Palladium and knowing that everybody there is there to see you? You must feel like God.
I don't know about that, but it's a mixture of being really, really nervous and just having a ball. I mean, I'd love to do the SSE again one day if we get the opportunity, but just to be able to say that we did it was amazing.
What's the biggest crowd you played to?
I sang at Crow Park, to the Pope. That was the biggest one. Yeah. So,
will you do one more song for us? I'm very conscious of the time.
I will.
You've got to get
sure.
back to Enniskillen tonight. What'll you do? Now you have a musical director and all in the audience. So like,
well, I should probably do a County Down song now.
Oh, that would be a good idea.
I need the lyrics though.
Could you say happy birthday to Anna Smith, who's 18 today? Anna! Where's Anna? Where's Anna over there?
Give us an A there, John. Anna, is it?
There she's there. Look,
happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Anna. Happy birthday to you.
There you go.
Yeah.
Happy birthday, Emer.
Happy birthday, Emer, as well.
Oh, Mary, this London's a wonderful sight, with the people here working by day and by night. They don't sow potatoes nor barley nor wheat, but there's gangs of them digging for gold in the street. But at least when I asked them, that's what I was told. So I just took a hand at this digging for gold. But for all that I've found there, I might as well be in the place where the dark moors sweep down to the sea. There's beautiful girls here, oh, never you mind. Beautiful shapes nature never designed. Lovely complexions of roses and creams. But let me remark with regard to the same, that if at those roses you venture to sip, the colors might all come away on your lips. So I'll wait for the wild rose that's waiting for me in the place where the dark moors sweep down to the sea. You remember young Danny McLeod, of course. Well, now he's over here with the rest of the force. I saw him one day as I was passing the Strand, and he stopped the whole street with one wave of his hand. And as we were talking of days that are gone, the whole town of London stood there to look on. But for all his great powers, he's wishful like me to be back where the dark moors sweep down to the sea. But for all his great powers, he's wishful like me to be back where the dark moors sweep down to the sea.
Go on down. Lovely.
Put your hands together for JP as well. Thank He's travelled tonight to come along. JP, thank you very much. Very conscious you have to get back, because I'm sure there's a few people you'll be saying hello to before you leave. Two last questions. What's the worst thing about being Nathan Carter?
To be honest, I'm very lucky. There's not really anything that bad, you know.
No. That's a Daniel O'Donnell answer. I want a Nathan Carter answer.
Okay.
The worst thing about being Nathan Carter.
The only thing that really does annoy me is when you're about to tuck into food and someone goes, Nathan, can we grab a picture? And you literally got chicken in your mouth and you go, oh, yeah,
certainly.
Give me 1 minute. Yeah, that's what.
Well, we finish on a positive. What's the best thing about being Nathan Curtis? You don't have to say it. Nathan, on behalf of the Centre, thank you so much for your time. It's been an absolute pleasure. Nathan Carter, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Can I just say continued success to Gerry? I know he's been doing this for the last number of months, and maybe you'll do some more later on in the year, but continued success.
Thank you. Thank you.